Good morning. Our prelude today is number 347, Gather the Spirit.
Welcome to First Unitarian Church of Orlando. My name is Linnea Nelson, and I serve on the worship team here. Our words of welcome today are from the Reverend Meg Barnhouse. We gather to worship, our hearts alive with hope that here we will be truly seen, that here we will be welcomed into the garden of this community, where the simple and the elegant, the fluted and frilled, the shy and the dramatic, complement one another and are treasured. May we know that here each contributes in their way to the beauty of the whole. Come, let us worship together. All genders, sexualities, progressive or conservative, may we root ourselves in the values of this faith: compassion and courage, transcendence, justice, and transformation. For more information on our congregation, go to www.orlandouu.org or email welcometeam@orlandouu.org. And after the service today at 11:30, please join us. All are welcome to the informal fellowship to gather with each other, and we just chat for about 20 minutes. Or if you're new and you have questions about our congregation, drop by our Welcome Center, and we'll be happy to answer your questions. And as you know, our Share the Plate offering benefits an outside organization providing important services to the community. And this month, our community partner is Planned Parenthood of Southwest and Central Florida. And a special event today at 3 p.m., there's an online interfaith service sponsored by the Interfaith Council of Central Florida. We'll celebrate the life and legacy of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. This year's theme is Love and Power, with keynote speaker Florida Representative Anna Eskamani. Several leaders from various traditions will participate, including our own Reverend Sam. And that's at 3 p.m. today. A link was in Friday's weekly update, or search for Orlando Interfaith Service, Love and Power. Being active in the wider community in interfaith and activist events is just one of the many ministries of this congregation. So it's important that we financially sustain our community to do its work in the world. I turn to this church in challenging and confusing times like the ones we are in now. Each layer of challenge to our community and our country results in more sadness and more anger. Being with you here on Sunday mornings, as well as in the activities throughout the week, sustains me. So I support the ministries of this church, knowing that one you is a beacon for many during these challenging times. If you'd like to make an offering to support the many ministries of this congregation, and you can also give a gift to our Share the Plate campaign benefiting Planned Parenthood, go to orlandouu.org. and click the donate button in the upper right corner, or send a text, or send a check. It's so good to be together again.
Good morning. I'm Samuel Schaal, Transition Minister. These words of Martin Luther King Jr. call us together this morning. A time like this demands great leaders, leaders whom the lust of office does not kill, leaders whom the spoils of life cannot buy, leaders who possess opinions and a will, leaders who have honor, leaders who will not lie, leaders who can stand before a demagogue and damn treacherous flatteries without winking. Tall leaders, sun-crowned, who live above the fog and public duty and private thinking. Come, let us worship together.
Good morning. We're the Du Bois family. I'm Mary Du Bois.
I'm Bob Du Bois.
Unitarian Universalists light a chalice at the beginning of worship to set aside this time as sacred time. Please say with me our familiar words.
In the light of truth and in the warmth of love, we gather to seek, sustain, and to share.
Good morning. I'm Sarah Gray, religious educator here at First Unitarian Church of Orlando. Tomorrow, we celebrate the life and the accomplishments of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. I probably don't need to remind you all of the impact he had on the civil rights movement back in the 1960s We will actually talk about him more this week in our at-home RE lesson, which was made available on Friday in our RE weekly update and will be posted today on our private RE Facebook page. But for today, for this service today, I want to invite you to listen to an abridged, illustrated version of his iconic I Have a Dream speech, made in Washington, D.C. all these years ago. I invite you to listen and to reflect upon his words in the context of our modern struggles for civil rights, equality, democracy, and equity. Which of his dreams have come true? Which of his dreams are still a long way off from us achieving? What can we do as individuals and as a community to persevere in this dream? I Have a Dream by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Paintings by Kadir Nelson. I say to you today, my friends, that even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the heat of injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted and every hill and mountain shall be made low. The rough places will be made plain and the crooked places will be made straight and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. This is the faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountains of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day when all of God's children will be able to sing with new meaning. My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing, land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. So let freedom ring from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire. Let freedom ring from the mighty mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania. Let freedom ring from the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado. Let freedom ring from the curvaceous slopes of California. But not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And when this happens, when we allow freedom to ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old spiritual. Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, free at last.
As we enter a time of mindfulness, of meditation and prayer, we take time to hear of the joys and concerns in our community and in the world. This morning, our hearts are with Jenny, who lost her brother Jeff in Nashville, apparently from COVID-related complications, week before last. We send our supportive thoughts and love to Jenny and her family at this time. And Bonnie reports that her office building caught fire last Sunday, a week ago. In the floor above her office, she has found temporary office space and has recovered most of her office belongings. She's grateful for the support of her clients and friends. And as always, we remember the unspoken concerns with us. We know that the love of the sacred shines into the dark and broken places of our lives and all life. And now let's take a deep breath together. Knowing by the very act of breathing, which we do hundreds of thousands of times a day, we act out our interdependence with each other and with all. And now let's sing to open our hearts.
I may speak with bravest fire and have the gift to all inspire and have not love, my words are vain as sounding brass and hopeless gain. I may give all I possess, and striving so my love profess, but not begin my love within. The prophet soon turns strangely thin. Come, Spirit, come, our hearts control. Our spirits long to be made whole. Let inward love guide every deed. By this we worship and are freed.
When we go into the silence, you may use either Facebook comments or Zoom chat to name anyone in your life who needs prayer, remembering, or honoring in our communion of names. Our meditation today is from the works of Egbert Ethelred Brown, an early African-American Unitarian minister who founded Harlem Unitarian Church in 1920 and endured discrimination from his own religious tradition of the day, followed by a prayer from Marjorie Bowens Wheatley, who many of us knew, who served in many capacities in our movement, including as minister here in Florida, in Tampa, before her untimely death in 2006. Now, we hear these words from Egbert Ethelred Brown. As we face a troubled and puzzled world, we too are troubled and puzzled as our fond dreams remain unrealized and our bright hopes of yesterday wither in the bitter disappointments of today. Our courage fails, our spirits droop, our faith trembles, and frustrated, we bow our heads in despair. May we know that without love, there will never be peace. Teach us, therefore, to love. And for Marjorie Bowens Wheatley.
O God, about whom we know so little but ask so much, goddess of justice, giver and sustainer of all life, your daughters and sons, all your children, call upon you once again as we did in centuries past. We have known war, and once again there are rumors of wars, and so we come this morning to lay this burden on the altar of prayer. We know that violence cannot sustain us, and so we seek a new way, a way that leads to peace, a way that leads to the promise of freedom, justice, and security for all the peoples of the earth. And so we are mindful of the sufferings in our community and the world. We pray for all those who are hurting in any manner of body, mind, or spirit. For these and for all, we pray for a greater sense of fulfillment, health, vigor, peace, relationship, abundance, and sufficiency in all things. Now, with the private meditations of our hearts, we enter the silence in the communion of names. And so it is. Amen. Blessed be.
Go out and tell our story. Let it echo far and wide. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. How justice was our battle, and how justice was denied. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. And say to those who blame us for the way we chose to fight, that sometimes there are battles which are more than black or white. And I could not put down my sword when justice was my right. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. Go out and tell the story to your daughters and your sons. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. And tell them in our struggle we were not the only ones. Make them hear you. Make them hear you. Your sword can be a sermon or the power of the pen. Teach every child to raise their voice, and then, my brothers, then will justice be demanded by 10 million righteous men. Make them hear you when they hear you.
Your sword could be a sermon. Indeed, in the life and work of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., his sermons were swords, swords for justice. And so many of the speeches he gave in his work were certainly full of that spiritual activism and language and concepts grounded in a life of faith and the ethical expressions of that faith. We remember him primarily as a civil rights activist, and that he certainly was, but he was also a minister. Being a pastor and a prophet empowered him to lead a nation into a greater reality of equality. The mid-20th century civil rights movement largely came out of the black churches of the era. The churches were a backbone of the movement, especially in the South. The movement, I think, rolled from the churches to the streets to the television sets of that generation, something new in American culture, that helped to awaken the conscience of a nation, certainly not everyone, not everywhere, but enough so that it rolled to the legislature and eventually to the desk of a president, where it was signed into law, the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Certainly that legal act did not solve everything, but it gave a legal context for greater equality and provided a road on which we are still making a journey toward greater equality, to confront racism and white supremacy. My preaching professor in seminary was the Reverend Dr. Zan Holmes. Dr. Zan, as we knew him, was then senior minister and now minister emeritus of St. Luke's Community United Methodist Church in Dallas. He was a civil rights leader in that arena as well. And in our class, he reflected that the American African American religious tradition had two primary elements, praise and protest. We Unitarian Universalists get the protest part, certainly. There is so much these days to protest. We are now in 2021, according to the Project 400 of Case Western Reserve University, looking back at the 400 or so years of racism on this continent and in this nation, says that includes 246 years of slavery, 99 years of Jim Crow laws, and 87 years of lynching. Certainly, amid those terrible statistics, progress has been made. But that we have not yet arrived at the promised land is certainly clear, if by nothing else than the events last week at the siege upon the U.S. Capitol. In that insurrection, racism was not just evident, it was paraded literally with flags, signs, and symbols of racist, white supremacist, and extremist groups. This, of course, on top of so many needless deaths in this last year, so many names, so many souls, so much tragedy continues. In the recent elections, there was one interesting election that it felt to me as if mirrored Martin Luther King's era. Now, speaking of the election of the Reverend, now the Senator-elect, Raphael Warnock, to the Georgia Senate. He is, of course, senior pastor of Ebenezer Baptist Church in Atlanta, the very church that King was co-pastor of until King's assassination. Warnock's political campaign speeches were very frequently full of the religious phrases and ideas of his own religious tradition. And he got critiqued heavily from his opposition on some of the what were considered extremist or radical views of justice. And in the Washington Post, in an opinion piece, Jonathan Lee Walton wrote about the background of Warnock's approach and point of view. He said, "The attacks misconstrue African-American progressive and prophetic religious protests informed by the evangelical strand of the social gospel. This tradition places an overwhelming moral emphasis on society's most vulnerable and oppressed. It demands that Christians bear witness and ameliorate the sufferings of others as set forth in the parable in Jesus 25, where Jesus likens our treatment of God with how we treat those without food and shelter or those who are sick and imprisoned. That is an expression of the engaged spirituality, of the spiritual activism of both protest and the beginning of praise, a vision of an equitable world. The Bible is an interesting work. It has been used to support both oppression and freedom. Again, from the Washington Post, a headline several years ago said, "The Bible was used to justify slavery. Then Africans made it their path to freedom." Indeed, during abolitionist times, the Bible was used to do both. The African slaves took the religion of their slave masters, a religion that on the surface seemed to at least the slave masters, promulgate oppression, turned it upside down, and it became a religion of liberation. They saw in that old story of the crucifixion the story of an innocent man killed by society and yet loved by the eternal, loved by God. And in that story, they understood their story of how they could be blessed while imprisoned in slavery and later in living as oppressed people in a Jim Crow South. And so it was that a century later, the civil rights movement was born in these churches and made its way out into the lives and legislation of a nation and planted a vision of hope and freedom. In one of Dr. King's many sermons, this one titled "Transformed Nonconformist," King said, "We live not merely in the colony of time, but our ultimate allegiance is to the empire of eternity. Be not conformed to this world, but be you transformed by the renewing of your mind," he quotes Paul. King said, "We are citizens of," quote, "two worlds, the world of time and the world of eternity." I think the weight of the world of time is especially felt by those under the yoke of oppression. And the promise of the world of eternity is especially transformative to those who are oppressed. So this transformed nonconformist, Dr. King, saw in our broken world a dream, a vision of eternity breaking into our lived experience, of equality, of justice, of true love breaking into our experience. This was something worth working to get to. There was, even in the difficulties of that day, something to praise. Closer to our own generation, in the weeks following the attacks of September 11, 2001, Polish poet Adam Zagajewski wrote, "Try to praise the mutilated world." It was a poem of resistance to tragedy, resistance to pessimism, resistance to the beauty that is not always so apparent. King himself, in a highly quoted phrase, and we've all heard this, we all use it a lot, he reminded us that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. By that he meant change, justice, can take a long time, but it can happen. He, of course, was paraphrasing 19th century abolitionist Unitarian minister Theodore Parker in that phrase. I've told you before in a sermon, we also have invented a phrase called bending the arc, that we need to bend the arc. Well, I think in my own understanding that the arc is, if you will, already bent toward justice. It was created that way. The universe was created with justice in mind. But that just means a propensity to justice. It doesn't mean that justice is going to happen naturally. It is up to us, the human creature, to take the tools we have and to work with the eternity we can but barely glimpse, to take the promise of justice and to make it real in the world. But it, at first, is not our vision. It is a vision outside of us that we take and build upon and bring into expression It doesn't happen on its own. Justice is a gift from beyond, I think. It's an orientation of things, not the full expression of things. I am inspired by the gift of the African-American religious tradition, which gives us a sense of transcendence to do the work of the church in the world. Some will call this transcendence God. Some will use other labels. It matters not what we call it, but we need a sense of transcendence. This, I think, is what we can praise, even and especially in the difficult days of our generation facing untold, unusual challenges that no generation has faced, just as King did in the challenges of his. This week, as our nation pauses to honor the work of this great man, may we in that pause give thought to what in our lives has been given to us by the greater reality we live in, and so may we give praise, and may we be aware of the heaviness of oppression that maintains itself in the lives of so many people, even and especially in our own nation. And to that, may we give protest. And may we work for greater justice and peace in our own lives and in the world. Above all, may we carry forth the spirit of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. as we seek to become a more justice-seeking nation. For indeed, we walk with Dr. King and all the followers of his philosophy and faith of all the generations into the light from the shadowed past. So may it be. Amen.
Civil rights activist James Weldon Johnson wrote Lift Thy Voice and Sing as a poem, which was set to music by his brother John Roseman Johnson in 1899. The song is now known as the Black National Anthem in America. It is a protest, a hymn, and a prayer of profound significance for our people. We lift every voice and sing to express ourselves. We lift every voice to show that we have strength in numbers and we will not be silent. We lift every voice and sing to be lifted, liberated, and free.
Freedom, the power to determine action without restraint. Freedom, the absence of or release from ties, obligations, or restrictions. Freedom, the ease or facility of movement or action. Freedom, frankness or boldness in manner or speech. Freedom, a political right. Until we are all free, none of us is free. Black lives matter. Black lives matter. Black lives matter.
Lift every voice and sing.
Till earth and heaven.
Rejoicing, rise.
Cleansing our path through the blood of the slaughtered. Out from the gloomy past, till now we stand at last. We're the white people of our Christ's story.
God of our
We extinguish the flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment.
These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
Remember, my friends, we haven't just been to church. We are the church. And when the church is the church, it is nothing more, it is nothing less, it is nothing other than a place in the world that sings the harmonies of liberty in a world of cacophony and noise. This week, be the church, go in grace. Amen.
Spirit of life, come unto me, sing in my heart all the stirrings of compassion. Blow in the wind, rise in the sea, move in the hand, giving life the shape of justice. Roots hold me close, wings set me free. Spirit of life, come to me.